Okay, Judy says we are ready to go. This is Calvin Castine. We are in the what is this room called? The meeting room? The
banquet hall, room. Banquet room. Meeting room.
Banquet meeting room at the American Legion Post 912 facilities here on Pratt Street in Rouse's Point. We're hoping this is the start of a series. We want to talk to people that have served in Vietnam. And over the years, we were able to get a few people from World War II and a few from Korea to talk with us. And the more of these people that pass away, you realize that you wish you could have done more and more stories. But a lot of those folks were reluctant to talk. There's something about having served in wars that sometimes they might sit around and at a Legion function and reminisce with each other, but talk in general public, it isn't always that readily, and sometimes people just don't want to talk about it.
Right.
So I asked Mr. Robert St. John, who is very involved with different veterans groups, if he could start gathering some folks, and we've got some other folks in mind, and there's supposed to be another guy here today, and hopefully he might remember and show up. But we have Ed Gelineault, a former classmate of mine for just a little period of time.
Yeah, very short. Very short time.
And Mr. Robert St. John, Bob, you're involved in a bunch of veterans organizations. What do you do?
Well, I'm involved with the American Legion. I'm the Clinton County American Legion Commander, and I'm also the 4th District Vice Commander for the American Legion. I'm also in the VFW Post 1418 as low as Eddie. So I'm also the historian here for Montgomery Post 912. So involved in trying to compile our history here for this post since we got our first charter in the early 20s. So.
Okay. So before I forget, I wanted to look up the era for the Vietnam War, so I went on the internet, and many of the sites say it started in 1954. That's when we first got involved there with advisors,
right.
They were called back then, and ended, of course, in 1975 with that last helicopter flight out of there. So our involvement there started very closely to Korea. Korea was 50 to 53.
Mm-hmm.
But coming up very shortly here, we're doing this on March, I think, the 23rd today. And on April 6th, we're going to be remembering the 100th anniversary of our involvement in World War I. Started on April 6th, 1917. Mm-hmm. And if we look in the Press Republican and their look back, they're 100 years ago, they're talking about the training going on in Plattsburgh at the camps there. They're talking about World War I. They moved to the 75 years, and they're talking about World War II. And they moved to the 50 years, they're talking about Vietnam. Mm-hmm. It's just, you know, it's just one war after another. And we, so I graduated in 1964 from St. Mary's. I was 17, born in 47. And we were hearing about Vietnam and stuff in school. And by the time the 1964 elections came along, it was very much on everybody's mind. You know, Goldwater was saying we have to get more aggressive. Mm-hmm. And LBJ was trying to find a way out. So, you know, Goldwater didn't get too far there. But it was just really starting to take off when I got out of school. Now, what did you? When did you get out of school? At
69. Yep.
Okay. Yeah, that's when you got out of school.
Yeah.
High school.
Yeah.
You were my classmate.
Yeah.
I graduated in 64.
I don't remember. It was 65, maybe. I'm not sure.
We didn't graduate together, but he came over to St. Mary's for a little period of time.
Time and faces just slide by. At this age, they slide by quicker. You know?
You realize you've lost all credibility in this interview right from the first question.
Exactly.
So any reminiscences that Ed Gelineault has, take them like a grain of salt, I guess.
Why, yes.
I'll ask you an easier question. When were you born? What year was it?
1945.
45. Okay.
Yep.
And Bob?
1951.
51. So you're the baby here.
Yes.
When did you graduate?
1969.
Okay.
I actually did graduate then.
Oh, see, it was his graduation.
You were reading his mind.
Telepath.
Stop doing that. That mind melding stuff. Okay, so, and if either of you guys has a question for the other, as one of you is talking, and you know, don't be bashful,
right,
and figure I got to ask all the questions. You know, if you got a question that Ed says something, and you know he wasn't your classmate, feel free to speak up.
When did you really graduate?
You think 65.
I think it was 65. I was held back for a year, and I kind of lost track of it. And then I went to St. Mary's for a short time, and then I had to go to the high school because they didn't want me in the school down there. St. Mary's? They wanted to keep all the real bright ones there, and I wasn't one of the bright ones, so.
We had standards back then.
Yeah.
I guess we never had them. I was north at Champlain Central at that time.
That's a public school.
That's right.
You take whatever you get.
Well, back then they didn't have any idea of different things that were wrong with kids, and I have what's known as, and I don't remember the term, but where you invert your numbers.
Dyslexia?
Yeah, you invert numbers. They didn't know any of that in school. And when you do
letters too, and letters.
And letters too, yes.
Yeah.
And when you do a test and under pressure, I invert stuff. It's pretty hard to do real good on tests if you start inverting all that stuff.
Yeah.
So I never really did good. In later years, I guess they realized what it was. Actually, the high school, they realized what it was after I had did a math class. The third semester, they really looked at the test and they realized what I was doing with my numbers.
Uh-huh.
And then after that, there wasn't a problem.
They call it Gelineault disease.
Yeah. It's just like knowing when you graduated.
So I got out in 64. Didn't turn 18 till 65. And I've got bronchial asthma. So I got that nice little card that said 4F.
Right.
And later on, I'm not sure what year the draft came in, but they put out number, and I ended up with a high number too, with the lottery
Selective
number.
Service, right?
Yeah, and the lottery, they came to a lottery number.
Mm-hmm.
But in 65, there was no lottery number, and I think as you were mentioning earlier, if you didn't get drafted, you joined because you didn't want to get drafted, because at least if you signed up, you had a little bit of a choice into where you were going. So did you get drafted or sign up, Ed?
No, I signed up so I wouldn't get drafted, and I joined a unit in Vermont, actually, 131st Engineers. And by doing that, I was assured of having relatively local people that you would know from the same area and whatnot. And also, it was a really high caliber group of people because it was an engineer group, which running equipment is always interesting. And we had everything there from 290 pans to D10 dozers to 80 ton ukes. And so it was a more interesting unit to belong to. And when we went over, we actually were assigned a quarry that was full of water and whatnot, and we drained the quarry and we set up a rock crushing system. And also with our other equipment, we did a road up there. We had people that graded the road with big graders and whatnot, and spread tarmac, and really upgraded a whole road.
Okay, now, so what year did you go in 65?
No, I don't know. If I knew those numbers tests, I would have read up on it. But I think, actually, to tell you the real truth, my discharge paper has all that when I went in, when I went out. But I didn't bother bringing it with me to...
You didn't know there was going to be a quiz.
I didn't know you were going to have numbers. You always have been with numbers, eh? Dates and numbers.
Well, you could make up something, and Bob and I wouldn't know the difference.
65.
Unless you tell us you went in 82 or something. And we might catch on.
No, but I think I got out in 69.
Okay.
So I think I went in at 68.
Four-year term, you think?
No.
Yours was a two-year?
It was 2 year active duty.
Okay.
Now, I was in there for half a year, three quarters of a year before. And then I went to basic, and then shortly after I got done basic, the unit got called up and activated. And actually, we spent our stateside getting prepared to go over in Fort Belvoir, Virginia. And we were pretty well ready to go overseas, but not many units do this. But our unit, our guys got tired of being stateside. So they really ended up writing our representatives and saying, look, either send us over or send us home. We didn't want to just sit stateside. They wanted to be active. They wanted to be doing something. So
did you sign that?
Yeah, I did. I wanted to do something. You know, I wanted to. And we were lucky over there because we were an engineer unit. That's the other thing. So I wasn't pounding through the jungle like a lot of people.
Uh-huh.
And we ended up able to take a swamp and convert it with real bunkers, and because we had a crushing unit. Plenty of stones, so we weren't in the mud and the water and stuff. And so it really was not a bad service time. And to tell you the real truth, the country itself of Vietnam, I can understand why the communists want it, because of the amount of farming growth for rice and everything else that it has. It's rich, rich, rich country and beautiful sandy beaches with clear ocean and stuff. I liked it enough, I almost went back as a contractor. But the only thing that stopped me from going back as a contractor is you never knew when somebody was going to come up with a gun to try to shoot you.
That'd be a good reason.
And that's, yeah. And, you know, when you're in a unit, you're in a unit, but when you're by yourself, you're by yourself. And the one thing about running the heavy equipment we were running, you never bothered, you didn't know if somebody shot at you, because you had enough noise from the motor. Unless something hit you, you didn't really know. So they could have, for all I know, they could have shot at me while I was over there several times and just missed. I wouldn't know.
Not even hearing the pinging off the equipment.
No, you wouldn't even hear the pinging at all.
You'd count all the dents in the equipment when you went out and count them when you got back, and you know.
One of the things, one story about doing the road, when we were doing the road, and of course it was dirt to begin with, and then we tarmacked it. Well, because of the 290 pans, which have huge, huge wheels on it and whatnot, they used to kick up so much dust, you couldn't see. The boys tend to drive a little bit faster than they should. So they had a colonel from the head office come down, and he was going to catch the guys that did it. Well, he got out on the road, and the first truck that came towards him, he pulled right off into the ditch because it was a big 290 Ute, there was no room for that Jeep. And then the other four that went on by him, he was just covered in dust. He couldn't see anything. And they did tell us about it in formation the following day, that we had a colonel out there, and he wasn't happy that. But he never came out again.
He
only came out that one.
He was a fast learner.
Learned his lesson quick.
Okay, Okay, so is that a National Guard unit you were in?
Yes.
So, okay. So for those first 6 months, were you one of these guys we'd see driving right through here, coming from Vermont over to Fort Drum that used to come through the village here on a regular basis?
No. We did some of our camping and stuff was done all right in Vermont.
Okay.
Right at a area they have over there. And, of course, we worked on our trucks and stuff. And I can remember the one day that I was working in the garage, and there was a couple of us working on a truck, and we were changing oil. Simple job.
I could do that.
It's not as simple as it sounds.
Oh, maybe not.
You got the guy down below, and he drained the oil and whatnot. And I'm up above, and he slides out from underneath, and he says, okay, we're all set. I start pouring oil, and after about 5 gallons of oil, they yell, you know, there's oil coming all over the floor here. He never stuck the plug back in the bottom of it. So it's not as simple a job as it sounds.
Well, the plugs go opposite the normal plug. Those oil plugs, they're not the normal.
No, he must have just stuck it in, and it popped right out. And
must have been a Vermonter.
After about, well, yeah.
Hopefully nobody from Vermont. Right?
Calvin said it. We didn't.
Did you go into a reserve unit or whatever after you got out? Were you part of?
Yes. When we came back from overseas, they gave us a choice. We could stay in the unit active or go inactive, but be in like a reserve call-in thing. And I served 2 years. 3 years like that.
No, inactive reserve.
Do you still have to go once a month or that type of
thing? No. Not in the inactive, you don't. It's just if something big comes up, they just call you back.
Off you go.
Yeah.
All right. Are we okay here, Judith? Okay, well, I got to check with the director here, make sure we're okay. And Bob, you graduated in 69?
I graduated in 69.
Graduated with me?
Yeah, right. I don't remember you, Eddie, but graduated in 69, and in September, I went to Clinton Community College. And in fact, I was the first class at Clinton Community College. That when they first formed it in 66,
uh-huh.
And the first class that went there was in 69.
Oh,
so,
really?
Yes. But then college life didn't agree with me. I didn't really, you know, care for that or whatever. And that's when I thought about, you know, enlisting. So went down to Plattsburgh, and, of course, that's when the recruiting office was at the big federal building downtown. And at that time, with Vietnam really going on strong, I walked into the front doors, and I had every recruiter come out of their office, the Marine, Navy, Air Force, whatever, and I walked right down to the Air Force recruiter, and I enlisted in the Air Force. And that was October of 1970 was when I went in to the Air Force. I enlisted for 4 years and went to basic training at Lackland Air Force Base in Texas. Spent 6 weeks there. Then towards the end of your basic training time is when they come in and they actually tell you where you're going to be, the job you're going to be doing for the Air Force. So there was a whole group of us sitting there in the barracks. And the training instructor called out my name, and he says, Robert St. John, he says, you're going to be a parachute rigger. And I says, what? He says, you're going to be a parachute rigger. I says, well, how's that going to help me in civilian life when I do get out? Doesn't make any difference. The Air Force wants you as a parachute rigger. I says, oh, okay. So left Lackland and went up to Chanute Air Force Base and ran to Illinois for 13 weeks of training as a parachute rigger.
And I gotta ask, what's a parachute rigger?
Parachute rigger is an individual in either any branch of the service that actually packs the parachutes that are gonna be used by the aircraft
or if they're going to be paratroopers or whatever. One thing about the Air Force was is that you were never required to have to jump. So I didn't have to go through jump school or anything. We were just trained to pack these parachutes for the ejection systems for like the F-4 aircraft, where when I went to Southeast Asia, where I was stationed, that's what we had was F-4s and different other aircraft. But
so you were bringing the Marines and the Army guys who were going to have to jump.
Actually, it was just the Air Force. That's the only one.
You didn't have to jump. Why'd you have the parachutes?
Well, we in the Air Force, the parachutes are used for the emergency escape from the aircraft that is going down. So, versus same way with the Marines, same way with the Navy. The Army's the one mostly with the paratroopers or whatever that go in. So after my 13 weeks of training there, my first active duty base was El Central Naval Air Facility. So here's an Air Force guy, parachute rigger, going to a Navy base. And the Navy base was located in the middle of the Mojave Desert in El Central, California. What it was a joint parachute test center by the Navy and the Air Force. There were 200 Air Force personnel on the base. The rest of it was Navy. It was an actual Naval Air facility. And it was also the winter home of the Navy Blue Angels. So we had the Blue Angels stationed there, and they'd be flying over every morning practicing or whatever. So I was there until I went over to Southeast Asia in October of 1971. And as a rigger, if you have one of your parachutes used by an individual, tradition is that you get a bottle of champagne from that individual for actually saving their life. My first one that I got was when I was stationed at El Centro, as they tested different parachute systems there, and the main chute that a Sergeant Powers was using failed. So he had to use his reserve chute, because they have two of them, reserve that they wear on their chest. He used that chute, and come to find out, it was mine that I had packed.
Now what about the guy who packed the one that didn't work?
Well, I don't know. I guess you never know about him. So came to the shop, the parachute shop, and that's when I got my first bottle of champagne. So then I had orders to go to Thailand, which is borders Laos, Cambodia, Vietnam. So that was my involvement in the Vietnam War, was in October of 71. I went over to Udorn Royal Thai Air Force Base as a parachute rigger. The first 2 weeks that I was there, I was attached to Detachment 156 Special Operations Wing, but they had too many riggers at that location, so I got transferred to the 432nd Field Maintenance Squadron at Udorn Royal Thai Air Force Base. And I spent until October of 72 with the FMS over there. And while I was there, I had a pilot that ejected out of an F-4 over North Vietnam, and there was a newspaper article in Stars and Stripes there, and then it was also put in the North Countryman here at the time, where the pilot came into the shop wanting to know who packed a certain chute. See, when we pack a chute, there's a booklet that goes with it, and your name, when you pack it, your name goes on that booklet, and it gets part of that backpack that the parachute fits in. So they know who packed that parachute. So, little accountability.
Yeah.
If it doesn't work, well.
They know who to blame.
Yeah, right.
It's not just getting the credit, it's getting
exactly
the blame, because this is life and death every time these guys jump out of there.
Right.
Now, I'd be surprised that you needed that many parachute riggers, because you wouldn't think that the instances where they need to use the parachutes would be all that often, but apparently.
Yes, we had in our shop, the parachute shop, we had about 2025 personnel.
Wow.
That, and because you're, you know, with all the it's on a cycle too, with the chutes that come in, they have to be inspected on a regular basis, unpacked, mm-hmm. checked, repacked, sent back out or whatever. And that's the norm for whether it's Vietnam or even now for a parachute system. I got my second bottle of champagne when he came in, and you know, and so then after the year there in Thailand, I was stationed at Loring Air Force Base in Maine, which was the 42nd Bomb Wing, and I spent 4 years in the Air Force, got out at Loring in October of 74, and then came back to Ross's Point.
Well, this guy is such a patriot, Ed. He lived most of his life on Liberty Street here in Rouse's Point. That's how patriotic this guy is. Now, I asked you, started telling us off camera earlier about this this stuff that you were building. Now, you never got any permits from the EPA to build all this stuff in the swamp there in Vietnam, did you?
No, never had anything. But I'll tell you a little story about, like, I was lucky. I was assigned to a Euclid. Which is a big dump truck to carry real super heavy loads. And I would go a short distance, just across the road, to the quarry, back to the crusher, dump to the crusher, back and forth. But I really liked it because it was a civilian vehicle. And the military vehicles, when you ride them, you're like sitting right on a flat board, bouncing like mad. And this had a nice piston air seat. So I actually got the... the piece of equipment that you could ride. It was easy, automatic shift and everything. And it had two of them. And we only ever used one. I could keep the crusher going just because I was so close with just when we had two. But at one time, our officers got the idea, some officer got the idea, let's start storing this crushing. So they got a dozer over in the field off to one side. And they started, and they gave somebody out the other uke, and they started hauling the crushed stone over there and dumping it and pushing it with the dozer. When I told them, when they started doing that, because I was used to the uke and understood it, I said, you make sure that whoever is driving that, it was an easy truck to drive, that they don't go next to the edge at all. There is a lot of weight on that. I mean, say, way away from the edge. Let the dozer push it. They got the pile up there fairly high up in the air, and I look over one day, and here's my other uke upside down along the side of the pile of stone. I said, well. And that was it. They never started. They never kept piling. After that, they brought the other uke and parked it. And
did the guy get hurt? Or?
No, I don't think he got hurt. No, he didn't get hurt, but
terrible way to learn a lesson.
Well,
but I had told him ahead of time because I knew what would happen because I knew the weight of the vehicle, and it's high up, so it's a little unstable.
Sure.
And it's kind of like our 290 pants, which is a really big piece of equipment. It has a big tractor in the front of it pulling it, and there's a big like dump in the back, but they have like hydraulics and stuff, and they can drop the floor of that pan down, and when they drive forward, it will scoop dirt and stuff up into it. When they first started doing it, when they first were there, and they were building the ramp for the crusher, I got pictures of this one 290 pan, and they got a little too close to the edge, and the tractor's sitting like this, and the trailer's off to the edge like that, on an angle like that. And the other thing I've had with my, that I've run into too is, we used to have regular convoys going to Cameron Bay to pick up supplies, bridge supplies, other type of supplies. And one time they went down there, and we barter and trade. The military did that, you guys did that in the Air Force too. They would barter and trade. So I don't remember what they traded, but they didn't come back with what they were supposed to come back with. They came back with two big beer coolers for us in the jungle. Beer coolers were supposed to go to some officers. Some officer PX somewhere or something but no, it came back to us to the jungle. And of course we could run it because of our big crusher. We had 200K generators that we had in the camp to run. So we could run all our electric that we had in the whole place and whatnot. So we ended up with that, and then the boys that would come in, like the ground pounders out of the jungle and whatnot, we'd have them come into the camp, and you know, they had been out there in the jungle for a while, and they could have cold beer and sit, and you know, so we had a few of those.
Are you sure you're not confusing this with an episode of MASH that you saw on TV?
No, not really. All this stuff happened. Really?
Now, appropriated equipment.
Now, is it the low alcohol beer? I hear about stuff in World War II with the low alcohol beer.
That was the thing with the military with the low alcohol beer. So
yeah, it was a lower alcohol. Yeah,
but if you like us in Thailand, all the bases are usually located next to a big populace or whatever in Thailand. So you could leave the base and go downtown, and the beer that's down there, the alcohol that's down there, was of like it is today, you know, with the alcohol content, because you were off base,
right?
You know, to be able to avail yourself of that. So a lot of us, you know, we wouldn't.
Some of the other guys, most of you would stay put.
Yeah, right.
I'm listening, Janice.
That air base that you had, was that a national base?
All the bases in Thailand were actually owned by the Thai federal government. And the Air Force was there at the invitation of the Thai government. So, but you had like our base. Our base was also, like I mentioned about Detachment 156 Special Operations Wing, was also part of Air America, which was the CIA. They also operated out of Udorn. They'd be doing supply runs or whatever into the jungles and that, supplying the ones that the Khmer Rouge or whatever from Cambodia and Laos or whatever. So, because we were in the northeastern part of Thailand, which you were only probably about 50 miles from Laos, the border. That in fact, you could take bus tours and go into northern Thailand or whatever. And if you wanted to, you could cross the river to go to Laos, Vientiane. But the only thing was that you had to leave your ID card or whatever on the other side with Thailand. You took a chance if you were going to, you know, go into Laos or whatever. You know, this is all part of when the U.S. government had their secret war going on or whatever, where they were in Cambodia and Laos or whatever. So
that worked out real well in Cambodia, didn't it?
Yes, it did. Yeah. It really did, especially when it got publicized with poor Richard Nixon there and the secret bombing and all that stuff that was going on. So
we were in a place called Bambi Tuit. Of course, we weren't in that village. We were in the jungle, a ways from it, about 20 miles away from it. But we were right next to the Mountain Yard villages, some Mountain Yard villages.
The Mountain what?
Mountain Yard. They are the hill people of Vietnam.
Okay.
Different race of people, different attitude from the Vietnamese entirely. Really primitive type of jungle people. But one time we went into a village, and when they have a funeral, they celebrate for like 4 days or 5 days. And they make this stuff in these big pots that stand like waist high or higher. And they have these bamboo straws that are in there that everybody sits around and sips out of. And I was not too keen about sipping out of this stuff because I won't even mention what's gone into it to ferment and whatnot. It is potent.
Now, if Ed Gelineault won't sip out of it, you know there's a problem, right?
But I will tell you, I had some brave Conrads. Now, everybody had to sip, so I stuck my mouth on the straw, my tongue over the straw, and, sip. But some of them didn't bother sticking their tongue over the straw. They were going to drink no matter what it was. I will say for 2 days to 3 days after they drank that, let's say the head was kind of full of people that had went to the village. It did not settle well in the...
So next time they were offered, they learned?
They didn't even bother. There was no next time. One time was enough.
Now, you're building a road, and you can't just stay in one spot. If you're building a highway, if you're building it a distance of 20 miles, you've got to travel.
Yep.
But, I mean, you're there crushing the stones and stuff.
The crusher unit stayed, but everybody else went out on the road. We had regular dump trucks as well as the big ukes. When we had graders. We had dozers, and they all went out on the road and whatnot. I went out on the road a couple days just to get away from something different to do. Uh-huh. And I actually traded with a guy that had a dump truck. And the dump trucks, of course, we can say that now because it's a lot of years. They used to race back and forth with their loads. Made it more interesting, other than just going up and down.
They do that a lot with the chip trucks now.
Yeah. Yeah, they do it with the chip trucks. So I think my dump truck was okay till we left Vietnam, the one that I drove, because I told the other guy about it. But it was a little bit laggy to the others. And they have what they call a pump for the fuel. And there's a sealed adjustment in there. So the first day, everybody beat me. But I did a little adjustment, and after that, I was the head of the pack.
He called Charlie Trombley. What do I do here?
But I told a guy when he came back, he took his truck, I says, keep your eye on your RPMs. Do not go over this much, because you'd be picking pistons out of the top of the hood.
They're made for power, not for speed.
This one was pretty fast. With a full load.
So, this road, that era, we just got Interstate 87 just opened up in 67, for just in time for the Expo 67 World's Fair.
Yep.
So I assume it wasn't some kind of interstate highway. You were doing this so our troops.
It was a little narrow road where you could fit maybe one truck in the center of it with no shoulders. And by the time we got done, it wasn't an interstate, but it was wide enough you could pass two trucks each side and you had some shoulder on it. And it was interesting. You see these guys with the paving machines that they load up. Well, we didn't have a paving machine. What we had was a 290 Ukes. Or the 290 pans, and those pans, they have the back of it through hydraulics and cable will come forward to dump, and they would load that up with tarmac. The graders would have things graded out, and they'd go along where it was, and they'd push the tarmac out and go along. You spread a lot of tarmac doing that really fast. The graders would come along after that, and they would level it a little bit more if they had to, then they'd roll it and it was down there. We put a lot of road down real fast.
Now, did this road extend into North Vietnam or this strictly into South Vietnam? I mean, closer you got, the fighting was going on both sides of the line, correct?
Yeah, but
there was actually no line. That's the thing with Vietnam. It's there were no lines of like it was World War II or whatever.
Right.
It was the whole country.
Yeah.
And, South Vietnam, North Vietnam, or whatever. Mostly in South Vietnam with your ground troops and everything, needing the roads or whatever, whereas North Vietnam was mostly for the bombing that went on.
In fact, like Udorn, all its bombing runs, their reconnaissance aircraft, and their MGCAP, which was combat air patrol to protect the bombers or whatever that were going in, everything that went out of Udorn went into North Vietnam as far as the bombing and reconnaissance and everything. So other bases that were in Thailand, some of them were dedicated just for bombing and reconnaissance in South Vietnam and that, but Udorn was mainly for going into North Vietnam. So
even though you're building this road in South Vietnam, the enemy is still there. So these guys are out there. Now, we all see construction in the summertime with you guys standing around with the thing, and there probably wasn't too many people out there manually doing this. It was mainly done from the safety of a relative.
Mainly equipment, mainly just with equipment, but we also had a tank unit guarding us.
Uh-huh.
And we also had artillery. There was an artillery hill a little ways away from us.
Guarding you guys, but the guys that were out there.
Well, I mean, the tank unit was out there along in the jungle. We didn't see them too much, but they were in the jungle along where we were doing the road and whatnot.
They had to run a perimeter there to keep the enemy away.
I'll give you an example. We pushed out probably 3,000 yards or more jungle away from our camp. And one night, there's a sniper that came in and did two shots into our camp. And we had, like I say, you trade to get stuff you wanted. We had twin 30s mounted on top of stuff. We had 50 calibers, which is an anti-aircraft gun. You don't actually have to hit a person. You just have to hit a tree. The splinters will kill them. And we had 60 calibers and grenade launchers. And the guy that fired the two shots from the area he came in, we dumped all that different type of ammunition there, plus the tank crew came in from each side, not where we were firing, but each side, and they were firing in the other way. So I assume the next time they said, "Hey, Charlie, it's your turn to go shoot at the engineers."
There were no volunteers?
The guy said, they couldn't not volunteer. Well, I'm sure he came out and he just sat there in the jungle quiet, didn't shoot at all.
He threw a couple shells in the ground. And, I come back with less shells. I shot at him, boss. Of course, you weren't laughing at the time, were you?
I really wasn't thinking. I was sitting on a 50 caliber and I was throwing ammunition out there.
You're reacting.
And the only other thing that we had one time, and I thought it was a rocket that landed in the... We were split up. They sent a regular army in there with us, engineers. And they were the guys that didn't have any equipment. They had like shovels and whatever. And I don't care. There's nothing wrong with pot or beer, but this particular unit used to use it even for guard duty. Well, if you're high and you're happy, you're not guarding very good.
Not doing your job.
And one of their officers tried to straighten him out, I think. And because he tried to straighten him out, that was one of those things that happened over there. I think he got fragged one night. We thought it was a rocket that hit. I was on guard duty, but it wasn't. But we had C4, we had all kind of explosives and grenades and everything. So.
And that means killed by his own soldiers.
Killed or injured by his own soldiers and whatnot. And the helicopter came in and
evac'd
him.
Yeah, and this, you mentioned the dope pot. I think this Vietnam War really helped to escalate the drug culture in this country, because on one side you had all the hippies that were out there marching, and of course that they lived on was the dope. But you had guys over there trying to cope, and one of the ways they would do it, I know, I'm talking to former classmates who come back, and that's how they got involved with smoking dope.
It was readily available
on both sides. the people who were actually fighting the war and the people over here who were the hippies and the radicals who were opposing it, you know, it really brought in that drug culture. And you wouldn't think that the military would have, but because of the circumstances, it became part of some of their lives.
Right. One of the things I have to say about that is that's one of the things that I was lucky in joining a National Guard unit, because we were country boys out of Vermont and upstate New York, and really, our guys really weren't involved in the drugs really at all. We only had, everybody knows everybody. So we had one guy that was what you call a pothead. He got sent home early, but the rest of the unit, all that rest of that unit, they weren't drinking on guard duty, and they never used pot, period. So, but it's a difference because you get such a mix up. You know, if you're in the regular Army, you got people from all over the world and all.
Sure.
But up here,
at the
psyche of the people up in the North Country and in Vermont, you know, are different than some people that live in Philadelphia in the city or somewhere else.
Of course, that has changed drastically, particularly in Vermont, as we well know.
Now with the heroin epidemic that we're having.
They're seriously talking about legalizing marijuana, about
up to an ounce.
Safe places for them to inject. Right. But that's not what we're here to talk about.
Right.
No, but I'm just giving an example of how the camp was.
Yeah, right.
And that's the only time we ever got any, when I saw any firing.
When you came back, did your whole unit come back? Okay, see, that's kind of the difference with going in as in a guard unit or whatever, where the whole unit, whereas most of us that enlisted and went in, when our tour of duty was done, we came home alone. You know, you were on that aircraft from Thailand, Vietnam, to Clark Air Force Base and such, right into San Francisco. You left out of San Francisco, you came back to San Francisco, and then you were on your own. You know, I mean, you came back with a bunch of guys that were rotating out because their year was up for their tour of duty in Southeast Asia. But once they got to Travis Air Force Base, then you were on your own. You went home wherever by yourself. You know, you're in uniform or whatever, just stepping off the plane, and, you know, of course you've been there where it's, you know, 90, 100 degrees, you know, wet, humid or whatever, and even just flying into California, you know, 60 degrees or whatever, it's like you're in short sleeve shirts, you know, and it's like, son of a gun, you know, it's pretty darn chilly over here, you know, after spending a year out in the high humidity and everything. But, and I think that's where a lot of you get that stigma where, you know, you're by yourself and you're walking through the airport or whatever, you know, and people are looking at you, staring at you or whatever. And that's where the stories came from of, you know, a lot of the protesters, the hippies or whatever that were there at the airports and that, knowing that every day there's somebody coming back home or whatever.
They're blaming you for the war.
And they're blaming, right, exactly, you know. So you kind of shy away, you kind of hide, you know, because it's where you get that. I mean, I know some guys that came back that the first thing they did was get out of that uniform and burn it. Mm-hmm. Because they didn't want to be associated with the Vietnam War.
So you wouldn't fly back into a base?
Yes, Travis Air Force Base in California.
So you wouldn't have the hippies and the
right, but there. But then you had to take a civilian aircraft to go there, like I did from Travis to Albany or whatever, and you're still in uniform at that point you get home, your actual home or whatever, because you have that time period of when you get home before you have to report to your next duty station. And so when you were traveling, you didn't have time to change your clothes or whatever. You're going from that flight and from Travis, you're going to the airport to catch another flight to go home. So you're, you know, by yourself in uniform. And that's what a lot of them had to put up with.
And a far different attitude than when the World War II guys got back and...
Right, and the same way as it is today, you know, where they come back and it's, you know. And that's not,
none of us begrudge the guys, gals of today coming back and getting that, because it rightly so. We as veterans or whatever understand, especially during that time period, when we were coming back, we weren't accepted. They're accepted, and a lot of us Vietnam tour and Vietnam era vets accept that because we don't want that to happen right. to them. What happened to us when we came back?
Right, saying,
there was no gratitude.
Right, you're not you know. Saying they didn't treat us right, so they can't. You know, you want the
right,
people to be
exactly.
treated right.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. And that's one of the probably the biggest things that with the Vietnam vets in your legions or VFWs or whatever are saying is that never again will we let the American public treat our veterans, our people who are actively serving now, the same way as the Vietnam veterans were treated when they came back.
Now, you said you went to college at Clinton in 69 and 70. Was it still a college deferment available?
Yes, there was. You still had that, if you could, an S1 deferment for a student, as long as you kept up your studies or whatever. If you didn't keep up your studies, then you went to 1A, which was draftable status or whatever. And so, you know, they did have that student deferment at the time.
Yeah, and you know what year the lottery came in?
I don't know exactly what as far as the lottery, but I remember when I turned 18 in 69, that's when I had to register for the draft.
Right.
You know. As far as once you registered, I don't know as far as if the lottery was ongoing at that time, where some number such and such through whatever number you need to report, or what. I don't know exactly when that lottery system came into effect.
I would have turned, I did turn 21 in 68. And I think by then, the lottery system was in effect. Now,
okay.
What the lottery system wasn't, you know, before it was just pull your name out of a hat, and if you got drafted, you got drafted. But the lottery system, you're born on April 12th, here's your number.
Right.
Here's your number. Here's your number. For that year. Every year, it had a new lottery system. So, and I think... But I thought they, when they did that, they'd gotten rid of the student deferments, but apparently not, because
no.
they were still active.
Right, yeah, in 69, 70, there were still S1 deferments. We had a lot of guys that were at Clinton Community that when they decided that college wasn't for them or whatever, too, some of them right off, before they got that 1A status, knowing that they were going to get it, decided, well, I'm going to enlist. Some enlisted in the Coast Guard, some, you know, going into or the Air Force or the Navy, knowing that if you went into the Army or the Marines, regular active duty, there was a good chance you were going to end up
right
on the line
in
Vietnam. So, you know.
So you didn't wait to get drafted. That's why,
right.
That was an incentive for...
Mm-hmm.
For most people,
right, and whereas the draft was 2 years, enlistment, especially like the Air Force, Navy, or whatever, was for 4 years, and then you did a 2-year inactive reserve, just the same as Eddie went through or whatever. Where if at that point they could call you back up, but most of the time they had enough people there in the services or whatever where they never reactivated you, but they had you as a commitment for 6 years, 4 years active, 2 years inactive reserve. So
when you went overseas, it was for a year usually?
Yes, it was a year of what they called, it's Southeast Asia tour of duty. And at that point, if you had served in that 1 year, you were there for that full year. If they wanted to send you back or whatever, if you didn't volunteer to stay there, or if they needed to send you back, they looked and saw, okay, you've already got a year, they'd give you time to where they, you know, would say, okay, we're going to send you back, but it wouldn't be right off.
A few months on.
Right, if that's, or even a year, because you had that commitment. See, mine was a 4-year commitment, and so I was there I still had a year and a half to go active duty.
Right.
Once I came back from Thailand, when I got stationed in Maine. So.
And then you had that 2 years where they could have called you back.
Right. Yeah. After 2 years inactive. Right. And then they give you your honorable discharge or whatever, and your DD-214 to show that you did serve in Southeast Asia for that 1 year time period, and so.
Back then, listening to the news, especially if you look back at it now, but there'd be a battle in some obscure town we never heard of, and of course we got our reports from the government, so they'd always say, well, we lost 30, but we killed 400 of them.
Mm-hmm.
It was almost like they were treating it like
keeping
score.
The big thing was the body count of the enemy that were killed. And one of the things that people really have to realize, this was the first actual war that was televised. With the newscasts every night and everything, you actually saw the battle or whatever, the casualties or whatever. And a lot of it was the fact of, with the, I don't want to say propaganda, but, the thing was is that the body count to show that why we are there, the reason we're there, and how many we are killing to stop communism from dominoing effect, controlling all of Southeast Asia. A lot of that had to do with the politicians and with your high-ranking officers in during that wartime period. General Westmoreland was one of the big ones as far as to this thing about body count.
But any speculation on how accurate the...
A lot of it, I guess you kind of... A little bit of estimation with what they were up against and hearing from the Viet Cong or the North Vietnamese Army, how many units they had there, how many units were involved, and how many units came back or whatever, So I think the body count was actually based on some of it was an estimation of what that unit lost versus actually going out there and trying to count, because not everybody was counted. It all depended on, when you're talking about dropping napalm and stuff like that, there's no evidence. Everything is incinerated. Everything is gone, or B-52 bombing where they carpet bomb the whole area or whatever. Nothing survives out of that. So I think it was more of an estimate as far as the loss of the North Vietnamese and the Viet Cong.
Go ahead.
I think one of the things, too, back in the States, that affected a lot of people here, and it still does somewhat, is that World War One and World War Two were actual wars. You had an enemy, and you continued fighting till you destroyed the enemy. And since then, Korea, Vietnam, and all these other units, it's just a containment type thing. You're not looking to finish something, write a final chapter in a book. You're just letting it lie there. And a lot of people in the States, a lot of people still today, they wonder why young people are getting killed and coming back maimed when they haven't accomplished nothing to take away from the people that are serving, but they haven't been let accomplish an end project, finish it.
Well, obviously looking at from both sides here, I gave that count of 30 to 300. Well, 30 families lost their loved one. And on the other side, 300 families lost their loved one. So really not much glory, but when you look at World War II, we were attacked. When you look at World War I, in both cases, United States tried their darndest to stay out of both of them.
And they were brought in.
And we were forced to get in there. And, obviously in World War II, there was no question that I've heard stories from my parents' generation, from, you know, people that served in the military and so on, that we knew that we were going to be attacked. But the only way we would get involved with is if we were attacked. Mm-hmm. Now, whether that's true or not, we have no way of knowing.
Right.
But it certainly sounds feasible, because if we hadn't gotten involved in World War II, this world would be a far different place than what it is now.
Well, that's absolutely correct, because there's no instance that I know of where our government has thrown the first punch, to say. We've always waited for somebody to give us a punch before we hit back. And as far as coming back home, the individuals coming back that had to go through the different airports and whatnot, had a heck of a time of it, and it's horrible. But our National Guard unit, to tell you, was, because it was a whole unit, we came back in three buses to Camp Johnson, and all our families were notified, so our families were there. They had the band playing there and whatnot. Mm-hmm. So when we came back, we didn't run into any of that stuff, which was good that we didn't.
Yeah.
Yeah, but like you said, it definitely scarred these guys that, mm-hmm. that came back. They weren't there by choice. You volunteered, but not because you wanted to volunteer, because you didn't want to get drafted, mm-hmm. basically. You know, you wouldn't have
right.
volunteered otherwise.
Right, yep.
So maybe you would have, but hearing the draft is a good incentive to to volunteer.
Right.
And so hardly mm-hmm. anybody was there by real 100% choice.
Choice, right.
You were there because your country asked you to serve. Now, whether that's right or wrong, we're not here to decide
right,
that right here, right now. But, but you did. Mm-hmm. You served, you came back, and in some cases,
mm-hmm.
the treatment was very, very shabby. But
yeah.
just because you're opposed to something doesn't mean you have the right, we still see mm-hmm. the riots now. People are opposed to something.
Yeah.
They got to go through the street, break windows, and riot.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of just saying, "Hey, we're opposed to it. We're gonna," you know.
Yeah, yeah, and really, it's with the Vietnam War towards the end, and that with the way the tide had turned, as far as the Americans' view or whatever, when you actually had Vietnam vets themselves joining in with these crowds or whatever protesting the war. And so America looks at it as, gee, we've got these guys that have come back that have actually been over there fighting or whatever, and they're seeing that, why are we over there to begin with? You know, why were we over there? And so the sentiment just escalated from there to where, no matter if you volunteered or if you were drafted, once you came back, you had that stigma
mm-hmm.
attached to you as a Vietnam veteran, you know. And more so, I think, in a lot of these larger areas than it was for up here, whatever, because it was more of the small town. Yeah, the boy went to Vietnam or whatever and was lucky enough to come back and we accept that individual because they grew up here, you know, whereas in the big cities or whatever, it just wasn't accepted that way.
Yeah. And as Ed said, it sort of looks like we never fought this to win it.
No, it didn't. In fact, if you look at the history of the Vietnam War, or you listen to some of the politicians back then and there, it was supposedly this threat of communism. As I said before, the domino effect, right. They're all going to fall. Now, I mean, Vietnam now is a very prosperous country, even though it did fall. And we do a lot of trade with Vietnam. A lot of products come out of Vietnam. So you look back and say, well, was it worth it? What was it? You know, at that time, we were just after McCarthyism and everything, and worried about communism taking over the world or whatever. And they, at that point, with Kennedy, with the advisors going in, and then LBJ going in and escalating it to stop the threat of communism. But the thing is that the United States whether, you know, always won every battle that they had, but they couldn't win the war because the politicians wouldn't let them go like they did in World War II and World War I. Now, of course, in Korea, you've got the, you know, the truce or whatever, and that's still going on today.
And today's, you know, right now, today it's, you know.
Right, it's a big threat.
North Korea.
Right, it's a big threat right now with North Korea.
And North Korea, the conflict, there was never a war.
Right.
It was a conflict that ended in 1953. Here we are in 2017.
Mm-hmm. And it's still, the tensions later, are still there as it was in the very beginning.
It's greater than they've ever been right now as we're speaking.
Yep.
Yeah, and in Korea, if they'd have let Patton go right through, there'd have been no problem. And at that time, they backed off. They were really worried. The Chinese sent a lot of soldiers in there. Mm-hmm. They were worried about them. But at that time, not now, but back then, we were the only people that had atomic weapons. They could have settled that war. They could have taken Korea without dropping atomic weapons there. But I mean, if China's going to send a million people, if you take the borderline out, I mean, I don't think they'd be sending more people over.
Well, it's just like Vietnam, because you had the regular Chinese that were in North Vietnam or whatever, and helping Vietnam during the Vietnam War. Same way as Russia was, you know. So it was all this threat: communist China, communist Russia, and where is it going to end? So we need to go into Vietnam and try and stop this because of the bigger picture of communism. And now, I mean, Russia is, once it got, you know, they're starting to come back or whatever, but then they didn't exist anymore as far as a, you know, a communist country. China still is and stayed as a communist country. Now we're having problems in around Japan and Thailand and all the other Southeast Asia countries because of China trying to expand its authority and everything with the islands that are around there.
Making islands.
Right.
No. You know, and there's, you know, in all these cases, I don't think, you know, we can look back and say, it's nice to look back and say this didn't work, so we shouldn't have done that. But at the time, you got to make
these. That's right. You make those decisions at that time.
And World War I, World War II escalated. Maybe if we'd gotten involved earlier, maybe it wouldn't. No. Who knows? So I think a lot of the thinking from these people who decided to get us involved in Korea or whatever, or even in Vietnam, was, well, we waited too long with World War II, and look what happened. You know, we waited too long in World War I, and look what happened. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I think none of us agree that what we did in Vietnam worked, but we have the benefit of hindsight.
That's right, with benefit of hindsight, and the fact is that you can't forget the individuals at that time that were put in that situation, and to say, well, it was hindsight, we shouldn't have gone or whatever, and let's just try and forget about it. You can't.
No.
You know.
No, there's still still people my age and so on that are still having Agent Orange effects on them. You know, some people who we know of have died from Agent Orange years after, just like we just had this the state trooper out of Morrisonville who just died out of the September 11th, 2001.
Yep.
And here, 16 years later, he's dying from that. And the same thing with the you know, soldiers that fought in Vietnam. They're still being affected. Some have died years later.
Oh, yes. And the sad part is that with the Veterans Administration, as far as not trying to not acknowledge that, so that way they have to put out the funds or whatever to help these vets out or whatever. A good example is all those troops that served in Thailand. Now, Agent Orange was used around the base perimeters to help kill the foliage or whatever around the base perimeters.
So you wouldn't have snipers in there.
Right, and also on the end of the runways or whatever. And they... any claims that are coming out of vets from Thailand, the VA says, well, when did you serve in country in Vietnam? Yeah, we know that Vietnam, Agent Orange was used in Vietnam. It wasn't readily acknowledged that it was used in Thailand, another one of these little secret things or whatever. And so every time a claim is made, they keep denying it by saying, well, when were you in Vietnam? No, I was in Thailand. Well, you need to show the proof. Well, the proof isn't there because they never proved, they never would publicize that they were using Agent Orange. So a lot of these conditions or whatever that are covered by Agent Orange, a lot of these Thailand vets are not getting the help or whatever from the VA for these conditions.
And that's where organizations like the Legion and the VFW get involved.
Right, where we advocate for these veterans, where our service officers in the VFW and the Legion are constantly, every day, fighting with the federal government to say, let's recognize these veterans and where they were, and they're coming down with these conditions at a higher rate than your normal civilians or whatever. There has to have been something to have caused this. And this is a chemical that was identified as causing these diseases or whatever. Let's get it recognized.
Yeah.
And whereas the federal government, the VA, well, we don't want to have to be able to expend that money for all of these. So it's like you gave your year or whatever to your country to be over there, and then you're coming back and your country's saying, well, gee, we appreciate you being there, and now you're on your own.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
it's it'll never happen, I don't think, but it would be wonderful if for the veterans coming back, if they just received a card that they were a veteran and they could go to any hospital, to any doctor, and get what care they needed. And if it's service related at all, then have it taken care of by the federal government. This any big organization, as we know in government, and the VA is one of them, there's an awful lot of waste in there. And you don't get, not that they don't give good care, but it could be a lot better if it was individually put out. And the other thing is war. We talk about war, the Vietnam War, and we talked about a couple other wars. And Congress or the President will declare war. And this will never change either. This is my personal opinion. But if you're going to declare war, then you let your generals and the people that are actually running the war continue till they say, okay, we've done it. We've cleaned up the thing. This group here that were threatening us no longer exists. And that will never happen either, because Congress sits in Congress and they kind of run our wars from the Congress, from a desk.
That's right.
Their lives aren't threatened. They haven't seen their friends killed, maimed, wounded, captured.
And it seems like there's less and less veterans that are running for political office or whatever. So we, as veterans organizations, need to be speaking up for those veterans when it comes before Congress or whatever and saying, you don't know what these veterans went through, but this is what they went through, and this is why you need to listen and change your policies. Okay.
We're going to pause just for a moment, and we're going to figure out what we're going to do next, but don't go away. Okay, we're back, and once again, it's a good thing the camera was off while we were talking here. Now, we do want to get up and wrap this up. I've asked these guys if they had more Vietnam stuff they want to talk about, and I think they pretty well said what they needed and wanted to say. But, Ed, you were telling us off camera, we want to wrap up and find out what's happened to you since you got out of the service. You said you went to college for a while.
Oh, I did. I went for 3 years on the VA, GI Bill, and did really good. But I was married at the time, had two children, and I would work in the summer so I could draw unemployment in the winter, and I'd draw the GI Bill, and I had enough money to go to school and still take care of the family. But after 3 years that ran out, the government says, oh, wow, you've got 3 years of college now. You pay for your own. And I happened to be, I was lucky enough to be working summers at Wyeth. And so I decided I would stay there since I had a family because I was making good money.
Right.
And luckily enough, they kept me. And I stayed there for 30 years. And I actually made more money than if I'd have finished up and got my degree. But I was happy to go to college, and I was happy to make the dean's list and do better than I used to did in high school. I did a much better thing as far as grades in college.
Did you send the results to the nuns?
No, no. I don't. I don't think she. No. She would have still said that, you know, your spelling isn't very good. You know all the work, but you can't spell it right.
Where was it you went to college?
Right here, Plattsburgh State.
Plattsburgh State? Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. No. Yeah, no. 4-year college. I had a 4-year degree. Actually, my third year, all I had was electives, which if you don't know what electives are, it's you can take anything you want from finger painting to basket weaving to anything and fill in the credits that you need to fill in and get your 4-year degree. I had all my requirements done in 3 years.
All the finger painting.
Matter of fact.
Advanced finger painting.
Yeah. One year the courses I did, and I didn't realize it, I filled myself up with too many credits. I went through the whole semester, and when I got to the end of the semester, my guidance counselor called me in. She says, you know, you're like 10 or 15 credits over what you can actually do. I says, what do you mean I'm over? I said, it's the end. I've passed all the courses. I did the credits. And well, yeah, but we can't give those credits to you. You can't. Worked out okay because they allowed me to get those credits the following year without going to all the classes. But I was really worried that, you know, here I did the courses and I spent all the time doing them, and I wasn't, and why, I don't know. I guess it's just because if you do too many courses in a year and you pass it, you're not there to pay the money for the following year.
Right.
So that's, right. That's the only thing that I could
You
think.
Caught on.
So how long are you retired now? When did you?
It's been a good 15, 20 years that I've been out
been
of the
long?
Yes.
Out of Wyeth?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Really?
Wow.
Been a long time. Well, the first group that left. When they were
15 years. How long was that, Judith? 10?
When's the first group leave out of there? They left long.
She doesn't know.
See, that, I'm not the only one that can't remember dates.
Okay, Judy left in 09, but she wasn't the first wave, so.
Well, I was one of the first waves, and the reason I laugh is because I really liked what I did. I was in maintenance, and I got to fix things all the time and see people all the time. But if I did not leave, junior people would have had to leave. And with the time they gave me.
The incentives.
And the incentives, I made out good by leaving.
They were able to bridge a lot of people up.
And I've always said that it was the best job I had. The only way I'd leave is if they paid me. And they did, so I left.
Well, they didn't pay you while you were there? They only paid you to leave?
Well, they paid.
They paid them more to leave than
they paid me more to leave than to stay.
And for those of you who are have no idea what the heck we're talking about, we've had a Wyeth Aris plant that's since been bought by Pfizer that's been closing up for the past 10 years at least.
Since 05,
so that's 12 years. And they did offer incentives to the older employees. And as Ed said, it allowed some of the younger employees to stay there. And plus the fact that sometimes these incentives, they wouldn't guarantee that a year from now those incentives would be there. So you could have just been out of work and no incentives. So a lot of the older employees took those incentives and moved on. But so this plant that, what was the employment total at one time? Do you have any idea how many?
I won't give an exact number, but I will say it's close to 3,000 people counting Chazy.
Between the Rouse's
Point and Chazy, close to 3,000.
A lot of jobs are down now to a few hundred, and it's
one time we had 1,000.
So this plant is closing up, and within this, you know, they've had times before where they said it's all going to be done within a year, and looks like maybe this time it might be accurate, but time will tell. But it's down to a few hundred employees. So that's what Mr. Ed Gelineault is talking about. We're talking to Ed Gelineault, and we're talking to Robert St. John. And Bob, what'd you do after?
Well, once I got out of the Air Force and came back here to the village, and I started working for the village, Ross's Point. I started working in the water filtration plant in 75. And I worked there until 79, when I started in 76 working part-time for the village police department, 76 to 79, and in 79 I took over as the full-time officer here for the village of Ross's Point. And I served there for 10 years, left in 86, seven of those years as the senior officer, police chief, or whatever. I left there and I went and worked City of Burlington, Vermont Police Department for 2 years, and then I got right out of that in 89 and went into private security. And I've worked in private security. I've worked for Loomis, the armored truck company, for 15 years. And right now, presently, I still with Securitas, a security company, and I work 1 day a week up at Pfizer, security there. So, and then the rest of my time is devoted to the Legion and the VFW and, you know, veterans and that, so. No.
Okay, and we want to invite, as I said at the very beginning here, we're hoping this is the start of many stories that we're going to do. We want to invite all the Vietnam vets out there who would like to sit down with us. We'd like groups of no more than probably three so that everybody can have their say. But we invite you to get a hold of, you can get a hold of Bob if you know Ed. Mm-hmm. He knows how to get a hold of us. Call Hometown Cable. But we'd love to do it through the Legions and through the VFWs and get together and do some more of these. And if there's any others who've been in the military, we don't want to slight you either. If you want to talk, we'll be more than happy to sit down and talk about you. And one of the things we didn't talk about too much today is very much in people's minds now is PTSD. And I'm sure there's a lot of guys from your era that you know, again, without getting into names, that suffered this and probably more quietly than what we do now, because now it's very much in the forefront, right, in the forefront, and people are being made aware of it. But so a lot of people came back from, you know, they used to call it shell shocked when you talked about the World War II veterans and so on, and it's World War I veterans.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people came back what we would have called shell shocked. Now they still have problems.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that's one of the things that the Legions and the VFWs work with these people.
We do a lot of it, especially our service officers that you know work a lot. And even with the present, where it's not so much of shell shock now, whereas it is traumatic brain injury and for all the different IEDs and everything that you know are out there that they've been exposed to. And suffering from that brain injury or whatever, you know. And a lot of the PTSD, because of the fact is that a lot of them are because of these IEDs or whatever, are losing limbs, you know, legs, arms, or whatever, you know. And that's one of the big things with the Legion and the VFW is trying to help these vets now, especially the high suicide rate. They're estimating at least 22 veterans a day are committing suicide because of PTSD, because of the TBI or whatever.
These are our best people.
And these are exactly, these are our best people. These are the people that have actually been there, and they just can't cope
with what they saw, what they were involved in, or they're, you know, seeing their buddies, whether they're male or female. You know, we lost a lot of female vets in this Iraq and Afghanistan era or whatever, and so it's not just the male veterans, but it's also a lot of female veterans. And even as the female veterans have different unique problems of their own that, you know, we as veterans and as veterans organizations need to keep the VA, you know, their feet to the fire or whatever, and saying makes no difference what era, what sex or whatever, you need to look out for your veterans because they looked out for you when this country needed it. So don't turn your backs on them.
Yeah, a little sign on my shirt says, all gave some and some gave all. And that is true of every military serviceman. Now, PTSD, did they have that in the Vietnam War? I mean, did they notice that when people came back? I don't remember if they even classified.
They didn't give a term to it. They didn't. At the time. No, it's the PTSD and TBI and all that has been a big thing from Iraq and Afghanistan or whatever. But it was I don't know exactly what the term was that was used during Vietnam or whatever. Like it was shell shock in World War One, World War Two. You know,
yeah, I never heard a term. I never heard a term.
No, I've never heard a term as far as the Vietnam vets, other than now they're terming it as PTSD.
But I don't think it was ever recognized in Vietnam.
No, I don't think so.
And right now, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, I think the largest number of homeless people on the street are our vets.
Yes, a lot of them are Vietnam vets.
Which is a sad, sad commentary. You have to wonder if part of that is because they have post-traumatic stress disorders, and that's, you know.
Yeah, and the large unemployment rate is because of that, because of the stigma that is placed on these individuals and on that disease or whatever. People don't want to employ them because they're afraid they're going to go off on them with all the other employees or whatever. So they're not even given the chance to become a productive member of society. So their backs are being turned on them, so they have nothing left but to depend on their own and become homeless and know that there's nobody there to help them. So.
Well, with that sad commentary, we're going to close this. I appreciate Bob St. John and Ed Gelineault, people I've known for a little bit longer, because he's just a youngster roaming the streets when we were hanging around. Ed, appreciate both of you taking the time.
We thank you for taking the time.
Yes, and I can remember the first time I saw you, you kicked your slats out of your cradle.
I still have splinters in.
That's good.
I want to thank Judy for running that camera and for the American Legion Post 912 for hosting us here today. And thank you for watching, and for those of you who support viewers.